topic was on the purpose of the church and the hope it brings in Christ. And while meditating on that, I was thinking, well, what does that look like for us as a church, as a body of Christ here on earth? What does that look like? And the first thing that came to my mind when he said that is, well, instinctively, we will think, well, it's about the purpose of Safe Harbor as a church, right? Because, okay, so maybe Safe Harbor is rebuilding. We're seeking God's face for guidance and counseling as to what to do next, where to go. So maybe the question should be, what is the purpose for Safe Harbor as a church? Which would make sense, right, at this time. And I felt the Holy Spirit leading me that that's really not the point. It's, permit me to say this, irrelevant what the purpose of Safe Harbor is if we don't know what the purpose of the church is. In other words, no church on earth should have a purpose of its own. There is one church, and the church is the body of Christ. So any church that does not have a purpose or a mission statement that is aligned with the purpose of the church as instituted by God does not have a purpose at all. Or at least should not have a purpose at all. The reason why many churches fail is not because they don't, it's not because they do wrong things. It's essentially because they are distracted by good things. See, the enemy is quite smart enough not to make you do wrong things because he knows you're smart enough. So he gets us committed in doing good things as opposed to right things. It's one thing to do good things. It's a whole different thing to do right things. What are right things? What God has called you to do. That's the right thing. So you can spend your time saying, okay, I care about people. I'm going to give. I'm going to pray. I'm going to do that. What happens is it's going to wear you out. Because even though it's a good thing, because it's not what God has ordained for you, it's not the right thing. So it wears you out. So it's important to understand this, that God is not committed to sponsoring your project. He's committed to sponsoring his project. Very important. So before you run off with, this should be the plan for the church, this is what we should do, this and that, if it's not in line with his will, he's not committed or obligated to sponsor it. Our plans, our will must align to his will, then he will supply all of your needs. The struggle comes when we're focused on, oh, let's do this. We come up with different ideas. Who has an idea? You have a great idea. You have a great idea. And God is just up there watching like, these guys have no idea. Why? Because we're distracted by what people want. We're distracted by how people feel. We're distracted by what people think to be politically correct, as opposed to what is God saying concerning the church. So if we're to answer what is God's will concerning Safe Harbor as a church, we must go back to what was God's intention behind the church. If you buy a product, in order to know how to use the product, you have to go back to who? The manufacturer. If you don't understand the manual, you go to the manufacturer, and the manufacturer tells you, the reason why we started this idea or this mission is for this, 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 and that. And then you align yourself with that purpose. And then God is committed to seeing that fulfilled. What people don't understand is the church is not just an organization. The church has great enemies. And if you let your guards down, your enemies will put you down. Jesus said, upon this rock will I build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail over it. He wouldn't have made that statement if the gates of hell were not after the church. The gates of hell are after the church because the gates of hell know that if these people succeed in what God has sent them to do, he's done for. So constantly the gates of hell are just looking for a way. He says the enemy is as a roaring lion seeking continuously who he may devour. The gates of hell will not prevail, but what will make it so that the gates of hell does not prevail? One thing, I will build my church, not you. You see that? Jesus said, I, not you, not the council, not the elders, not the pastors, not the ushers, I will build my church. So if you want to come with your own opinions, okay, you're not ready for a breakthrough. You're not ready. I will build my church. Listen, the kingdom of God is not a democracy. It's very important to understand that. And for those of you watching online, please remember this. I know you live in a democratic country, US, everybody, your opinion matters. Let everybody say what freedom of speech. That's not how the kingdom of God works. The kingdom of God is not a democracy. We have one king, and it's his will, and his will alone that must stand. Not your opinions. Not your perspective. This is not a majority carries the vote. There is one vote. So if you're going to succeed in this kingdom, your vote must align with the king's vote. If it does not align with the king's vote, it will not stand. God said in his word that my will and my purpose shall stand. It shall stand. It shall stand. Not your will, his will. You see that? But we're distracted by, oh, let's go get this thing done. It's a great idea. You know, let's get some people together. You get pumped up. You come to what you believe would be a church, and you're motivated and inspired. You see, what you don't understand is this. The motivation would only get you started. It won't carry you through. You're all inspired on Sunday, and then halfway through the week, you're torn down. Why? Because you're running on your own idea. The engine driving you is your own ideas. I will build my church, Jesus said, and the gates of hell shall not prevail over it. So don't get distracted by good things. Be disciplined and diligent enough to seek what the will of God is for your life. It's worth it. It's worth it. It gives you ease in life. It's worth it. Instead of running off a tangent and then going years without direction, spend time to seek God's will concerning your life. You cannot combine seeking God's face and pleasing people. The two don't go together. You can't combine them. So God tells you, yo, you go out there and speak truth to power. Tell them that I am against homosexuality. Tell them that I'm against lying. Tell them that I'm against premarital sex. And you say, God, you know, this is 21st century. I can't tell them that. I don't want to offend their opinions, you know. Everybody has a right to something. Ah! You dare challenge the king? Okay. You're not ready to break for your breakthrough. Because he said, Deuteronomy 13, verse 1, if you will hearken diligently to my commandments and do all that I tell you, all, not some, not the ones that feel appealing, not the ones that sounds good, not the ones that you think is right. If you will hearken diligently to all my commandments and do what? All that I tell you to do, see, it's the same old rugged cross, the same old, there is no modern gospel. Don't be deceived. There is no modern gospel. It's the same old rugged cross. If you will do all that I tell you to do, then and only then will I set you on high above all nations of the earth. But you must do all. When I tell you to go speak truth to power, tell them exactly what I said. See, that's why when I come up here, I don't cook the food of God. I don't cook it. I don't cook the word of God. He gives it to me raw, I give it to you raw. How you feel about it is irrelevant. When I step down the pulpit, we can become friends. But when I'm up here, it's what he says. Tell them, you must tell them. How they feel about it, no, that's not my problem. You see now? So when God gives an instruction, you obey. You don't try to say, okay, God says, okay, you want your breakthrough? Okay, go ahead once a week, seek my face and pray. And you say, okay, God, give me a second. Let me go ask for other people's opinion. So you bring your wise friends and say, you know, I'm thinking God is telling me I should pray. But what do you guys think? Let's vote on it. And three people say, no, you know, we're busy. We have kids, the church can be praying once a week, you know. It's a different time now. Everybody's on a fast, we can't pray. Okay, so let's vote.
let's vote. You have five elders, right? You see, we have five elders, three votes no, and two votes yes. So majority carries the vote. So, okay, no prayer once a week. And then you go back to God and say, God, I heard what you said, but we voted against it, so I don't think we can pray once a week. You know, God, you have to understand, it's a busy schedule. And God say, okay, have it your way. Why? Because you're concerned about what people think. People's opinion matters to you more than what God's opinion is. So if we must know what the purpose of the church is, or what safe harbor the church is, or any church on earth, we must go back to what was the purpose of the church? The church as instituted by God. Then we as a church align ourselves and our lives to that purpose, then we shall succeed and prosper in everything we do, because our will is now aligned to His will. We're not seeking our own private agenda anymore. Our will must be aligned to His will. Who's the church? The church is the body of Christ, not the building, the people. So that is not just aligning to the purpose of the church as ordained by God as a church, but even in your personal lives, at your place of work, in your families, in your businesses, you align with His will. And then from there, you move forward. So let's see what His purpose is for the church. Ephesians chapter 3, I'll read from verse 8 to 21, but we'll stop halfway through and talk a bit about it. Ephesians chapter 3 from verse 8. Paul speaking by the Holy Spirit, he said, "Unto me who am less than the least of all saints is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world had been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent," or to the purpose, "that now unto principalities and powers in heavenly places might be made known by" who? "By the church, the manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose which He purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord." So it's an eternal purpose. What's the purpose? The intent that by the wisdom of God, it shall be made known unto principalities and powers in heavenly places. The wisdom of God being made known by the church does not just demonstrate the power of God to men and women and people, but even to demons in heavenly places. That's how powerful the church is. That the power of God is manifested through His wisdom, through you, to the world, and to principalities and powers. That people would see God at work in your life and say, "Take me to the God that made this for you." It says, "The mountain of the Lord," in Isaiah, the prophet prophesied, "that the mountain of the Lord shall be exalted above all other mountains." The mountain of the government, mountain of finances, of family, of education, of media. "The mountain of the Lord," Zion, the church, "shall be exalted above all these other mountains. Then all nations shall flow into the church." Do you see that? So the church must be exalted above government, above politics, above family, above education, above finances, above businesses, above media, then all nations shall flow into the church. The powerhouse of God is in the church. When your priorities are not set right, you're missing the mark. And the church is not a building. The church is the people, because the church is the body of Christ. The church is the body of Christ. The people that have surrendered their lives to Jesus. That is the church. So the wisdom of God being made known. Your light shining. You don't go to God's presence and you select, oh, I don't want this. No, tell me what I like. Don't tell me this. Tell me what I want to hear. I don't want to hear this. That's what the Bible says. It says, in these last days, people will begin to look for teachers that will tell them. The people will begin to have itchy ears, looking for people that would only tell them what they want to hear. They don't want to hear the truth anymore. People with itchy ears. No, you speak truth to them like, no, that hurts my feelings. So I don't want to hear that. I have to go somewhere else. Okay. It doesn't change the truth. The truth remains the truth. So you want to leave? Okay. But that should not stop you from teaching and living the truth. Because in the end, what will prevail? The truth. That's what stands forever. Because who's building it? Christ is the one building it. And no hell can prevail against it. So for all nations to come into, he says what? We must exalt the church. So by wisdom, God doing marvelous things in our lives. What? The world will see and say there is something different about these people. There's an economic crisis out there, yet we're prosperous. There is sickness and disease outbreak there, yes, we're healthy. You think they won't ask questions? They will ask questions. They'll say, how? How is it that people are failing? And you guys are still making it. What's the secret? What's the secret? Look at this. Look at this. What's the secret? Zechariah chapter 8. Thus said the Lord, it shall yet come to pass that there shall come people and inhabitants from many cities. It's talking about unbelievers. Huh? They will come. And the inhabitants of one city shall go to another and saying, ah, let us go speedily to pray to the Lord and seek the Lord of hosts. And they will say, I will go also. He said, yea, many people and strong nations, verse 22, shall come to seek the Lord of hosts in Jerusalem, which for us now meaning the church or Zion, and pray to the Lord. Thus said the Lord, verse 23, in those days it shall come to pass that 10 men shall hold out of all languages of nations and hold on to you and say, take me to your God. For I have seen and I have heard that God is with you. That's what's going to happen in these last days. Unbelievers shall come and say, take me to your God. For what? I have seen and heard. Your lifestyle is different. Your breakthrough is not natural. The kind of health you have at this age is not normal. Take me to your God. I have seen. Joseph did not even speak to Potiphar. You know that? When Joseph went to Potiphar's house, Potiphar said, he could see the Lord with him. He didn't have to say, I'm a Christian. Because of the marvelous acts of God in his life, he said Potiphar could see that the Lord was with Joseph. As a result, what happens? People from every nation will begin to flow into the church because we stand out. You can either stand out with God or blend with the world. There's no in-between lines. It's not half and half. You either stand out with God or you blend with the world. But Malachi said that in the last days, people shall come and they will tell the difference between those that serve God and those that don't serve him. They will tell the difference between those that serve God, because in the last days, the Lord will make us like jewels, like precious stones. All that by the wisdom of God, being made known by the church, by the wisdom of God. We keep waiting for God to do spectacular things. Some of us are guilty, and I've been guilty of that. How many of you have prayed, oh God, America is going away from God and from what the foundations of our fathers have done. Oh God, do something in America and let them know that you are God. How many of us have prayed that? We've been guilty of that. Oh God, let there be earthquakes and signs and then we see things like the snow happening in Texas, like, oh, that's a sign from God. It could be. But what God is doing on the earth to make the men of the sons of men know that he's God, he's not doing it by himself. He's doing it through you. He's doing it through you to the extent to which you make yourself available to him. For the Bible says, the eyes of the Lord goes to and fro, looking for people whose hearts are upright, so that he can show himself strong and mighty on their behalf. He's doing it through you. Christ is not the church. I know that might shock some of you. Not the church. Christ, he's not the church. Christ is the head of the church. And we are his body. We are Christ's. That might be a bit heavy for some of you to take it. Now, be careful. I didn't say I am Christ. Neither did I say you are Christ. We are Christ because we are the body of Christ. Can the body do anything without the head? And can the head do anything without the body? So it means anything the head wants to get done on earth, because he's the head, he does it how? Through his body. I may be the eyes. You may be his hands. You may be his feet. So if he wants to reach the poor, Jesus is not going to come himself and reach the poor. What does he do? He uses people who have yielded themselves over. You could be his ears. You could be his feet. You could be his eyes. You could be his mouth. Christ is the head of the church, and we are his body. So when we yield over to his will and let him walk through us, then the will of God is established on the earth by the wisdom of God. By the wisdom of God. This is quite amazing how, second thing which we should talk about is this. It's amazing how many churches, especially newer churches, are so into wanting to please people that they put aside the mother of the church. Do you realize that the church did not exist until Acts chapter 2? There was no church in the Old Testament. In the time of Jesus, there was no church either. Now, there were temples, there were synagogues, but they were not a church. Those temples and synagogues were shadows and types of what was to come. It was not exactly the church. It was an example of what was to come. So the church did not begin until when? Until when the Holy Spirit came in Acts chapter 2. Put the Holy Spirit out of your church and you have no church. Put the Holy Spirit out of your church and you have what? No church. Because the Holy Spirit gave birth to the church. He's the mother of the church. Jesus Christ had taught his disciples, right? They had the knowledge to go and teach, but he told them, don't go and teach anybody yet, because you'll be wasting your time. Don't go and preach the gospel. Go up to the upper room and wait for the Holy Spirit. Don't run with the vision. Don't get too excited and run with the vision. Wait for the Holy Spirit, for he will empower you. So if the Holy Spirit empowers the church, the Holy Spirit must continue with the church. When the Holy Spirit empowered them, the Bible says they were filled with the Holy Spirit. He did not leave. So when you put the Holy Spirit out of the church and you say, you know, it's a modern day church. This thing about praying in tongues, we're not interested in it anymore. It's the Old Testament. It's with apostles. We're not interested. Gifts of the Spirit. No, we don't want that anymore. Healing. No, that ended with the apostles. You put the Holy Spirit out of the church, your church ceases to exist. You put the Holy Spirit out of your life ceases to exist. While you may not die physically yet, spiritually you're gone, because your connection with God is by the Holy Spirit. So you ignore the works of the Holy Spirit, you ignore the person of the Holy Spirit, you might as well be as a person who is not saved. The Holy Spirit is the mother of the church. The Holy Spirit is the pioneer of the church. The Holy Spirit is the mission driver of the church. Do you know that Jesus did not want to go to the wilderness for that 40-day fast? No. It wasn't like, oh, okay, I'm Jesus. I'm going to die for them, so I have to go. No. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit drove him. If Jesus needed the Holy Spirit to drive him, how much more you? The Holy Spirit, the Bible says the Spirit of God drove Jesus to the wilderness. A driving force from inside to get it done. Because in the power of your might, you can do nothing. You can do nothing. No matter how hard you try, you would wear yourself out. And it can, you know what? You can fail from the honesty of your heart. From the sincerity of your heart. Not that you're doing wrong things, but you lack the driving force. The driving force is the Holy Spirit. The force that drives the church to excellence is the Holy Spirit. Because God will give you some instructions that you cannot do by yourself. The Holy Spirit is that driving force. So the first thing to do is to welcome him back. To take his place. To humble ourselves before him. And say, in my life, in my family, in my business, I'm not having an opinion. It's whatever the Holy Spirit tells me I do. In my church, it's the Holy Spirit. It's not, let's vote on an idea, or what's your opinion, what do you think, or what do you think, what do you think? No. The Holy Spirit being the mother of the church. Look at verse 16 of that same Ephesians chapter 3. It says that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit. Strengthened with might by his Spirit. What happened after the Holy Spirit came down? Peter, who was a weakling, became bold like a lion. The same man that denied Jesus 3 times could speak boldly now. He didn't care what people thought, what their opinions were. No. Because the Spirit of God is a spirit of boldness. It gives you utterance. Even if you're the only one at work that identifies with Christ, you will refuse to compromise. You will choose to stand out. People may mock you. People may laugh at you like, oh, you and this, your Bible thing, you've come again. So-called Christian, you've come again. But because the Holy Spirit is with you, you will refuse to compromise. You may have roommates that smoke and take drugs, but you refuse to compromise. Not because you have the strength by yourself, but because the Spirit of God is driving you. And if you don't submit to him, then you cannot do that. Because it says he will strengthen you by his Spirit. Please, I beg of you, if you forget anything, remember this. Your Christian journey on earth would be the most miserable one without the Holy Spirit. You will struggle and fail and struggle and fail again and struggle and fail again without the Holy Spirit. That addiction would only be broken by the help of the Holy Spirit. Your willpower is not enough. Raising a godly home can only be possible by the Holy Spirit. Your willpower and your love for your spouse is not enough. Because we are fighting a real battle. There are forces that are set out against you. Whether you know it or not, not everybody is your friend. not everybody is your friend. There are forces that you cannot see that just hates you just because you belong to God. They just hate you. It doesn't matter what you do, how nice you are. There are forces that just hate you. And by all means, they want to pull you down. It's the Holy Spirit that will help you. It's the Holy Spirit. You start a business, it will fail without the Holy Spirit. You see, because the moment you went to God and say, I surrender my life to Jesus, that day, you made billions of enemies. That day. That same day. Some demons were like, you're for Jesus, huh? Okay, we'll test that and see. We'll test that and see. That same day you say, Jesus, I'm yours. Haven't you noticed that most people, when they give their life to Christ, then life seems like it's harder? It seems harder. Because that same day you surrender to Jesus, the attack that was on your life was doubled. Say, this one belongs to Jesus? Okay, let's try and stop him. But you don't have to worry about them when you surrender your life to the Holy Spirit and say, look, I'm not just a Christian. I'm not just an informed Christian. I'm an empowered Christian. I'm an empowered Christian, and I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The Holy Spirit is the mother of the church. He gave birth to the church, and he will nurture the church. So if you want to see growth in the church, welcome the Holy Spirit. You cannot become, contemporary Christians, you know, let's be non-denominational, everything goes, come as you are, go as you are, do whatever you want. No. We must align our lives with God. We must align our lives with the Holy Spirit. Oh no, you can't teach on this, you're going to offend some people. You can't say that, you're going to offend some people. No. What he says is what we do. Since the Holy Spirit is the mother of the church and the pioneer of the church, it means until his passion is our passion, then we're not going anywhere yet. What was the first thing the Holy Spirit did when he came down in the upper room? Souls were saved, right? 3,000 souls were saved. The heart of God, the passion of the Holy Spirit, is to see souls saved. That's his priority. That's his agenda. That's his whole mission. The first thing he did when he came, 3,000 were saved. Because it's not the will of God that anybody should perish, but that everybody should come to the knowledge of the truth. So until our hearts long to see what his heart longs for, then you're not in partnership. Amos chapter 3 verse 3 says, can two walk together unless they be in agreement? So we have to be in agreement with God. And being in agreement is to have a heart for the lost, a compassion for those out there in the world, a desire to want to see souls saved. A wise man once said, our life here on earth is like a blink of an eye compared to eternity. When that dawns on you, you want to see everybody saved. You want to see everybody saved. Your brothers, your sisters, your friends out there at work. You won't stop at anything. You would spend time praying for them. Because their life is on the line. If you see a burning building and someone is walking into the burning building, wouldn't you tell them? And if I ask you, well, why did you tell them they were walking into the burning building? You say, because of their life. I care enough for them to tell them, no. That building you're about to walk into is going to collapse. How much more their souls, and you know this. How would you feel when you get to heaven? Huh? You stand here, and God says, well, my good and faithful servant, you've done well. Come into your master's rest, right? And then behind you is your friend that you used to hang out with. Huh? And God tells him, you didn't accept Jesus. You're going to hell, or whatever it is. And your friend looks at you and said, you knew about Jesus all this while, and you didn't tell me. You knew about all this while, and you never mentioned a word about Jesus to me. Not God telling you, he's your friend. We hung out together. We played together. So you got saved, you received this good news, and you never thought to just even mention it to me that Jesus died for my sins. If that were me, that would hurt. That would hurt me. This is good news, and it's for everybody. Tell people about this good news. Stop at nothing. Yes, they may turn you down, but it's still good news. Don't stop telling them. Pray for them. Pray for them. Tell them there is hope. They don't have to suffer what the world is suffering. There is hope in Zion. That is what God wants to see. You see, God is not concerned about the stock market crashes. We have a new president, old president, Democrats, Republicans. You think he's concerned about that? God has been God before Democrats came. He's been God before Republicans came. He will be God after Democrats are gone, after Republicans are gone. He was God before America was instituted. After America is long gone, he will still be God. Nothing happening now is new to God. So these things that we're carrying on our head, oh, we're having division over politics and social media and all of, you think this is what matters to God? This contention that we have on the internet? Think that's what God is concerned about? He's concerned about the souls of men. That's what burns in his heart. Make that your priority. That I would tell somebody that Jesus loves him. Then think about the other side. Huh? The positive side. You get to heaven. And then God says, good and faithful servant, come in. And then your friend is right behind you. And God says to him as well, good and faithful servant, come in. And then your friend looks at you in your eyes and with tears in his eyes and say, thank you for telling me about Jesus. Thank you. Because if you had not told me, I would never have known. Sometimes we walk past people and we think they must have heard about Jesus. Don't make that assumption. Some people have never heard about him. Never heard about him. You'll be surprised. Some people, their whole family have never heard about Jesus. Maybe you're the one person God sent to pass that way. Maybe. So get the heart of God. Let your heart be hungry for souls. Praise God. With that being said, oh Jesus, we thank you. Severia Tibasha Tovrik Telepadis Kobaria Tele Blatave Classes. Pavlets Kefelesio Parus Kavanish et Klaplateve. I am the God of all flesh. There is nothing too hard for me. The silver and the gold is mine. The cattle upon a thousand hills are mine. What I say will stand. What I say will stand. Before I formed you, I knew you. I knew you before I formed you. And I have a plan for your life. It is a good one. If you will have faith in me, if you will trust me, I will take you to heights you could never dream of. Your age is irrelevant to me. It doesn't matter how old you are. I can still make waters to come out of the rock, and I can still make forests to grow in the wilderness. I am God, and there is nothing impossible for me. Let all eyes be bowed. And all eyes be closed and all heads be bowed. And if you're watching online as well, if you could just bow your heads and close your eyes. If you're here today or you're watching online and you have never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, this is an awesome opportunity. Going to church does not guarantee salvation. The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord, then you shall be saved. I don't want you to miss this wonderful opportunity. You might have been going to church for decades and for years, but you probably have never said yes to Jesus. This is a wonderful opportunity to say yes to Jesus. And maybe you're there and you've already said yes to Jesus, but you fell off along the way. You made mistakes that you know you shouldn't have made, and you've just disconnected from the church, maybe because you were hurt, or someone did something you don't like, someone said something that hurt you, and you disconnected from God. You were offended by that. I want you to know that God still loves you.
And whatever anybody did to you, it doesn't change who God is. It doesn't change the fact that Jesus died on the cross. And it's not a reason for you to lose your soul. So maybe you've said yes to Jesus before and you fell away. I want to welcome you back home. See, like that prodigal son, the father was waiting for his son. The father was waiting for his son. And God is waiting for you. Jesus is waiting for you to come back home. Because he loves you and he cares for you. The Bible says that Jesus is at the door knocking. If anybody would open, he would come in. I pray that you open up your heart today, for there is no love greater than this, that a man would lay his life down for your sins. There's no love greater than this. God loves you, man. I'm telling you, God loves you. It doesn't matter what you've done, the mistakes you've made. Don't let the enemy keep lying to you and locking you up in isolation. Come back home. Come back home. Come back home. It's not an accident that you're watching this right now. I'm telling you, it's not a mistake that you're hearing this right now. God sent me to you to tell you to come back home. Come back home. Because he loves you. There's no love greater than this. So if you're in one of those groups, I just want you to make this prayer with me. And believe in your heart. Say with me, Lord Jesus, forgive me. For I have sinned against you. I lost my way, but I want to come back home. Say this. Say, Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of the living God. And you died for my sins. And on the third day, by the power of the Holy Spirit, according to the will of God, you were raised back to life for my redemption. Thank you for your sacrifice for my life. Thank you for forgiving me my sins. For there is no love greater than this. That while we were yet in our sins, Christ died for us. Thank you for forgiving me. Say that, say that. Thank you for forgiving me, Jesus. Thank you for receiving me back into eternal life. I believe you, Jesus. And I ask that by your Spirit, you will strengthen me not to lose my way anymore. And that on that last day, I will see your face. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Son. Thank you, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. If you pray that prayer, I am happy for you. And I want to welcome you into this glorious family of love and hope. And I rejoice with you, and angels in heaven rejoices with you today as well. Welcome to the family of God. In Jesus' name.